that nation, and they shall come out of this nation out of this affliction. His seed shall be a stranger and shall be afflicted, but out of this shall come with great substance. God gave Moses a word of promise, in other words, to bring the children of Israel. This promise comes to them after 400 years of slavery to the Egyptians. The promise is, according to Exodus, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt unto the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and to a land that flows with milk and honey. Then when we get into the book of Deuteronomy, we read in chapter 6, he tells them, wait a minute. He says, I know that you told us this was going to be a land that flows with milk and honey, but I left something out. There are great houses over there. There are great and goodly cities that you didn't build that are full of good things which thou did not even work for. Amen. There's things there that are already flourishing. That there's wells there that you didn't dig. You got blessing over there. There's a God. There's a lot of great things. There's vineyards. There's olive. There's trees that you did not plant.
Yes, God.
He told them all the good things. But then he says, there's just one small little detail that I have to mention to you. One little thing. There is giants over there.
Lord.
And that brings us to our text in chapter 19 of Numbers. When we read this text, this chapter, Moses sends out 12 people to spy out a land and bring back some fruit or evidence of that land. They go out to the land and they spy it out, and they bring back figs and pomegranates and grapes, and the grapes were so big, the Bible says, that it took two men to carry one cluster on a stick.
Yes, God.
Too big that it took two men,
yes, Lord,
to carry one stick. The Bible doesn't say who these two men were, but I would like to think it was Joshua and Caleb. Because they were the only ones who agreed upon the promises of God.
Yes, God.
They were the only ones that believed that the land was theirs.
Yes, God. Mm-hmm.
12 spies announced it. And it's truly a land that flows with milk and honey, and there is some fruit there. But nevertheless, there were 10 that went on to say, but in our modern language, it would be, amen, that one word, but. The Bible says, nevertheless, but in our modern language, it would be, but. It would be that one student in the class that raised up his hand. It says, hold up a minute. And the truth of the matter is, when you see that word but, there's trouble up in the air. One little word can stop you and rob you of your faith. It can steal your health. It can rob you of your dreams. It can keep you from getting your miracle and slam the door to your promise. You know, you got those people that say, I know God can heal, but I know God can deliver us, but I know you can be healed, but I know God can open up the doors from heaven, but I know God can bring water out of the rock, but I know God can set up a table in the middle of the wilderness, but hold on. How many times we stood on the edge of our blessing, but that big little word comes out? How many times, amen, God's ready to move, and we fail to take possession because somewhere in this thick head, that word but shows up. Amen. Because we couldn't believe God was able to do it. And the truth of the matter is, every time you add the word but to the promise of God, it simply means you limit God to what he needs to do. Let me tell you this way. You disqualify yourself. You shut the door to what God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you may ask or think. But when you put the word "but," you say, "Check, check, I don't need you, God." Amen. Amen. They saw it. You limit God, his promises and his provisions. And these 10 spies, they all had that same problem. You know what they had? They had giants in their eyes. They were visionizing giants instead of the milk and honey.
Yes, Lord. Yes, God.
And at some point, as a believer, as a truster, as a person filled of the Holy Ghost, you got to make up in your mind, what do you want in life? Do you want giants or do you want the grapes? You got to get in your mind, amen, what do I really want? Do I want to have church as usual or do I want fresh rain, fresh fire, fresh Holy Ghost? I got to make up in my mind. See, God don't need all the young people, but if one of them make up their mind, something great can happen. See, God don't need all of AFT, but if one of them makes up their mind, something can happen. God don't need everybody saved, but if one gets saved, you and all your house can be saved. Am I going to look at the giants or do I get my eyes on the grapes? Hallelujah. The grapes are the promises, the blessings, the provisions of God. While the giants are the enemies, the adversaries to the promises and provisions of God. You see, the giants are employed by the devil to resist you, to frustrate you, to steal the promises of God from your life. There's all kinds of giants. There's a list that never ends. Fear, insecurity, infirmity, sickness, debt, depression, worry, anxiety, stress, family problems, marriage problems. The list can go big and big and big. Their mission, their prime mission is to keep you out of acknowledging the blessing of God. To keep you from enjoying the promises of your life. Don't we know that we are the temple of the Holy Ghost? That where I go, the Holy Ghost goes with. Yeah, that's true. It's important. When the sister goes off to college as she has gone, she's got to have something in her. Like she said, she's got some truth in her. And nothing and nobody will separate her because it's in her. It's in her. It resides in her. Amen. In your life, you are going to have giants or greats. And let me tell you the sad truth. You can't have both. That means you're going for the giants that are going to occupy your thoughts and capture your attention and let them decide your actions. Or are you going to decide that your actions and your control of your life, holy man, will be something different? Yeah.